Hello children, we are done with transpiration. We have seen that transpiration is a process of loss of water from the leaves. Then we saw that how we can measure transpiration with the help of photometer. Then yesterday we saw the mechanism of stomatal transpiration. That means we saw all the types of transpiration, that is stomatal transpiration, cuticular and lenticular. All these three processes we saw in details, as well as we saw that how the leaves are, you know, leaves which have the stomata, okay, these stomata which is present in the cells, they are present in the leaves, they are guarded by the guard cells, okay, they are just guarded by the guard cells, and the opening and the closing of the stomata is controlled by this guard cells, and how the process takes place and how photosynthesis and how transpiration is taking place in it. Okay, now we are going to see some external and internal factors that are affecting the rate of transpiration. So first factor that affects the rate of transpiration is the intensity of the sunlight. So here we can say that this, if the sunlight is more amount of sunlight, so more transpiration. So during the day we can say that what happens during the day, the stomata are open, right, the stomata are wide open, so lot of transpiration, more transpiration process will take place, more diffusion of carbon dioxide will take place for a photosynthesis, and therefore more transpiration will take place. But during a cloudy day or at night, the transpiration process is it does not take place, and when it is very cloudy, that time the transpiration process is reduced. Then the second factor which is there, it's the temperature. Here we can say that if the outside temperature is higher, okay, if the outside temperature is higher, then there will be more evaporation. More evaporation means more transpiration. So increase in the temperature will allow more water to evaporate, and the decrease in temperature will reduce the evaporation. So we can say that temperature, if the temperature is more is the rate of transpiration. Then velocity of the wind, temperature increases, okay, with the velocity of the wind. So when the wind will blow faster, okay, when the wind will blow faster, the water vapor released during transpiration will also be removed faster, and the area outside the leaf does not get saturated with water vapor. So we can say here that more the velocity of the wind, more is the transpiration. So intensity of the sunlight more transpiration, temperature more transpiration, velocity more transpiration. But now humidity. Now what is humidity actually? Humidity is the amount of water vapor present in the air. So if the humidity is high, transpiration is reduced. If the transpiration is reduced, if the air outside is humid. So higher the humidity in the air, it reduces the rate of the outward diffusion of the internal the water vapor across the stomata, and thereby reducing the rate of transpiration. So humidity, higher the humidity, less the transpiration. Then carbon dioxide, increasing in the level of carbon dioxide outside over normal, that is 0.03%, causes stomatal closure, and this results in decrease of atmosphere in transpiration. So if the level of the carbon dioxide is increased, again transpiration will be decreased. So here increases CO2, that is carbon dioxide, decreases transpiration. Transpiration is reduced if humidity is more. And then atmospheric pressure, here same thing, rate of transpiration increases with a decrease in atmospheric pressure, thus it enhances diffusion of water vapor. So atmospheric pressure less, increase in transpiration. So these are the external factors, which is intensity of sunlight, temperature and velocity of wind. If they are more, transpiration is more. If humidity is reduced, transpiration is reduced when the humidity is more, increase in carbon dioxide, decrease in transpiration, atmospheric pressure decreases, increase in transpiration. Okay, then we have the internal factor, which is the water content. So here, if the water content of the leaves due to sufficient absorption, okay, if the water content of the leaf decreases due to insufficient absorption of water by the roots, the leaves will wilt and transpiration is reduced. So we can say reduction in transpiration is indirectly due to the closure of stomata, okay, is indirectly, and it is a natural mechanism of conserving water within the plant. So it's a natural mechanism, okay, reduction in transpiration is not directly dependent on the closure of stomata, but we can say that it is a mechanism, it's a natural mechanism of the plant. So I hope these, the external and the internal factors, are clear. Now let's proceed further. What are the adaptations in the plants? So here we can say that the plants adapt themselves to carry out the excessive transpiration. So first, many plants and especially which grow in dry climate have this permanent adaptation to curtail transpiration. Curtail means to reduce. First is Sunken's tomato, that is a Nerium plant. So you can see here Sunken's tomato, which is covered by hair in oleander, that is Nerium. So here there is a Sunken's tomato, means the stomata will be inside, it will be deep inside, okay, by which is covered by the hairs. Then secondly, we have the fewer stomata, very less stomata will be present. Fewer stomata means again transpiration will be reduced. Narrow leaves like the spines which are there, these are narrow leaves, so the size of the leaves are reduced, like this very narrow leaves will be there, so that the surface area decreases and therefore less transpiration takes place. Then reduced or exposed surface, some leaves will be waxy, some will be rolled or folded so as to reduce. Loss of leaves, in some cases leaves can be dropped or absent or change into spines or mostly into cacti. And thick cuticle, some of them trees like banyan, they have cuticle present, thick cuticle. Thick cuticle is the plant covering. Now why, if you see, these particular adaptations are basically in the desert plants or in some plants where the rate of transpiration has to be reduced. As I told you that this is a mechanical, we can say mechanism of conservation of the water in the plant, so it's a natural phenomena. So these are all the adaptations which can be done, that is Sunken stomata, fewer stomata, narrow leaves, reduced exposed surface, loss of leaves and thick cuticle. Now here you can see that there's a cactus plant which is given. So here if you see, this is a modification of leaves into spines and by the cactus. So here if you see, the cactus is there, its roots are deep under the ground so that it can absorb little water. The stems are swollen so that some water content will be present in the stem. Then there are spines which are present so as to reduce the surface area, and transpiration also is reduced. Stomatas are sunken inside so to avoid drying due to wind, and the green stem which is there, it is it is carrying out the process of photosynthesis. So this is the modification of leaves into spines. So I hope the external, internal and the adaptations are clear. Now what is the importance of transpiration? So there are three major importance which they have given us. Is first is the cooling effect, second one is the suction force, or we can also call it as a transpirational pull, and the third is distribution of water and minerals. Okay, so let us see first, that is the cooling effect. Now whenever evaporation takes place, okay, whenever you feel hot or whenever you sweat, and then when you put on the fan, the sweating evaporates, right, the water which is there, it evaporates, and finally a cooling effect is produced on your body. Similarly, evaporation produces cooling. So evaporation which is there, it reduces the temperature of the leaf surface, and thus we can say transpiration is useful for the plants on hot sunny days, as at intense heat the enzymes are destroyed. Then suction force. Now transpirational pull. Now transpiration helps in the ascent of sap. What is ascent of sap? Movement of water and minerals from the roots, that is from the xylem, it will be taking place upwards from the roots to the stem. So evaporation from the leaves concentrates cell sap and increases their osmotic pressure. So what happens? Evaporation from the leaves concentrates cell saps, means there is a osmotic pressure will be created, right? How is the osmotic pressure? That is, we can say the movement of water molecules from high concentration to low concentration. Then because of this, what will happen? It will draw more water from the cells in a sequential manner, and finally it will favor the absorption of water. So whatever we learned in absorption of roots, the same thing, because of osmosis water will be absorbed and it will be sent up towards the surface. So this creates a transpirational pull which is beneficial for transpiration. If transpiration pull is created, you can see water passes up from the trunk, evaporation and atmosphere, that is transpiration. So here transpiration will be more, and again, so we can say it is a significant, it's a beneficial. So here figure 1.2 represents the transpiration stream. As the water evaporates from the leaves, a suction force is produced at the top of the plant, drawing more water up through the stem and making the roots absorb the water from the soil. So more water from the soil, more transpiration. Then distribution of water and mineral salts. So when this transpiration process is taking place, we can see the water spreading towards the leaves to stem everywhere. So because of this, the mineral salts or the nutrients which are beneficial for the plants are given out everywhere. Since leaves are present at the tip of the branches, twigs, transpiration from their surface tends to draw more water from them, right? More water will be taken, and the water will be reaching from the tip to the toe, we can say like that, thus helping the distribution of water throughout the plant body. So we can say higher the rate of transpiration, okay, greater the rate of absorption of water and solutes from the soil. Okay, so here significance, cooling effect, suction force, as well as third, distribution of water and minerals. So here transpiration and excretory process in the plants. No, it's not an excretory process. What is excretory process? Excretion is nothing but it's a process of removal of waste products, right? But here this is not a waste product, it is just the elimination or just the removal of excess water. So we can't compare transpiration as an excretory process. Then I hope the significance is clear. Then transpiration affects the climate. So it has been experimentally shown that plants give out large quantities of water during transpiration. A fully grown sunflower plant is estimated to lose about half a liter of water per day in the form of water vapor. So how much? Half liter. Maize plant loses 2 liters. Apple tree, a large apple tree loses about 30 liters. So these figures will give you an idea that how much quantity of water is released into the atmosphere by the vast stretches of fields and particularly forests. Thus we can say what happens? Because of transpiration, it increases the moisture in the atmosphere and brings rain. And in this way, transpiration from plants affect the climate. So forest contribute in bringing rain. Transpiration is the secret. This is the secret. This is why, that's why, that is the reason why transpiration is affecting the climate. Now there is a basic difference between evaporation and transpiration. Okay, so here we can say that evaporation is nothing but loss of water from the surface of water bodies in the form of water vapor. Transpiration is loss of water from the plant parts. Evaporation is physical change, okay, it is controlled by temperature, humidity of the atmosphere. But transpiration is a very vital, that is an important and physical process controlled by both external and internal factors. Just now we studied external and internal factors. Evaporation is faster than transpiration, but transpiration is a slow process. So this is the basic difference between evaporation and transpiration. Okay, then the next part which we have is the last part of this lesson, which is guttation and bleeding. Okay, some plants may lose water or other fluids along with dissolved substances directly in the liquid form and not as water vapor. This is known as exudation, which is exude means to ooze or sweat out. The fluid given out is called as exudate, and it occurs in two ways, that one is guttation, one is bleeding. Guttation we studied in the previous lesson also. So some plants are there, they will be given out some liquids. Instead of some gases, they give out some liquids, and this process is called as exudation. Exudation is giving out, oozing out. Oozing out means coming out or sweating out. So first process is guttation. So what is guttation? The leaves of certain plants, okay, exhibit droplets of water along their margins in the morning. And this particularly happens in plants growing in warm, humid conditions. So these plants which are there, which are in warm and humid conditions, these plants will be giving out some droplets of water, which is called as guttation. Now a humid environment hampers transpiration. Just now we studied, if the humidity is more, transpiration is reduced. Hampers means it reduces, while the roots continue to absorb water from the soil. Now what happens? Due to humidity present in the air, if there is lot of humidity, transpiration is decreased. But absorption of the root is taking place continuously, right? So because of this, a hydrostatic pressure, we can say it's built with a plant and forces out the excess water directly from the tips of the veins of the leaf. Hydrostatic pressure is because of the pressure of water. Water is being continuously absorbed by the roots. A very little amount of water is going out by the transpiration because outside air is humid. So finally what happens? A pressure is created, and because of this pressure, the pressure is given out by the veins of the leaf. So special pore bearing structures called hydathorns are present on the margins of the leaves to allow this exudation. So guttation can be observed in many plants, and it's quietly in banana, nasturtium and strawberry. Okay, nasturtium, you can just google the picture of this particular plant. Otherwise I would have shown you, but you just google it and just see what is this name. So can you see this small droplets of water? This is guttation. Leaves of herbaceous plants showing guttaceous. We studied about herbaceous plants. Herbaceous plants are those plants which are herbs, small plants. Okay, small herby plant. Those herbs plants are called as herbaceous. So can you see, this is the, in figure 5.3, you can see the guttation, that is small droplets. So here what happens in guttation actually? Leaves will be giving out certain water droplets. When the outside climate is warm and humid conditions. When the outside climate is warm and humid, that time it will be showing the water. And when early in the mornings, it will be showing this type of water in the margins. Now, why this water is shown? Because the roots are absorbing the water, okay, but transpiration is less, therefore a pressure is created, hydrostatic pressure is created, and the water which is there, it is forcing out from the tips of the veins of leaf, and then we can say that this process takes place. So these leaves which are there, they have special bearing structures called as hydathodes, and from the margins this exudation takes place. What is exudation? Exudation is giving out certain fluids, okay, or the dissolved substances in the form of water, which is called exudation. Now the second thing is called as bleeding. Okay, now what is actually the bleeding process? So this happens only due to injury, right? The plant sap escapes, that is bleeds from the ruptured or cut surfaces of the plant, and the root pressure generated by the plant assists in bleeding. Okay, so here this is the bleeding process which is given. So summing up, the figure 5.14 schematically represent the most of the phenomena related to the intake and the loss of water through transpiration. Now what is actually bleeding? If the plant is cut or something, so that is called as the bleeding. So here we can just feel, first see the differences between these two. Guttation occurs from the edges of the leaves by the hydathodes, but here the plants are not injured, but here the plants are injured, occurred from any cut or a injured part of the plant. Exudate is mainly water with some dissolved minerals. Here exudate is plant sap and sugars. Some of the plants, if you see the white colored substance which is given out, so we can say that that's the bleeding. Here this is occurring at morning, early mornings or late at nights. This will occur at any time. It happens in plants like banana, nasturtium and strawberry. This occurs in all plants that have been cut or injured. Cut or injured, you can see that white color oozing out, right? So that is called as blue bleeding. Okay, now here we are summing up all the process. So here figure 5.14 is showing the phenomena, that is 1 to 9. So first we will see we'll start with 1. Okay, this is a diagrammatic representation and path of water through the plant and various physical processes which are responsible for the movement. So first you can see here imbibition and osmosis. You know what is imbibition? Imbibition is absorption of water from the cellulose or the surface attraction. Osmosis, you know, movement of water molecules from a high concentration to low concentration. So here the osmosis will be taking place at the root. Okay, then the third process will be there, that is the cohesion, root pressure and capillary, right? This also we studied in absorption of roots. Cohesive forces, that is between the molecule, same molecules. Root pressure is created, that is the pressure of the roots, that is from cell to cell, how the cell to cell it will be sending, right? The mass movement of water. And then the capillary, the xylem vessels are like capillary. Because of that, what will happen? The water will be forced upwards towards the stem. So after the fifth process, the sixth process is taking place, that is the stomatal transpiration, which we studied that first it will go to the stomatal transpiration will take place slowly, it will reach over here, okay, and then the water, that full layer of the, that is everything, that is a palisade mesophyll layer, mesophyll cells, all that, and the water will be coming out. Then seventh one is guttation, which we studied now, and the cuticular transpiration which is there, that is taking place. So, and the ninth one which is there, that is spongy parenchyma and intercellular spaces which is there. So here lenticular is there, spongy parenchyma, cuticular, guttation, all these processes giving into one. You can just see cohesion, as I told you, between the same molecular attraction, root pressure, cell to cell osmosis, okay, then pressure is created, capillarity narrowing, giving more amount of water over here, stomatal transpiration will take place at the leaf. This is the stem, this is the leaf, this is the root. So this is the complete mechanism of absorption of water and transpiration. I hope all the concepts are very, very clear to you all. Now your part is to just revise this lesson again and try to complete the question answers of till fourth lesson. I'll be telling you about this fifth lesson next time. Okay, thank you children. I hope all the things are very clear with you. Take care of yourselves.